I greet you again, End Time Message Church Assembly at the Willows, Pretoria, South Africa. These broadcasts are intended for my local assembly. Those who listen in, you are welcome, but my motive is clear. According to Ezekiel 34, verse 2, our technicians will put it up for you to read. I like the line that says, should not the shepherd feed the flock? Our title is going to be Paradigm / Pattern. When I was growing up and learning the English language, I remember the first time I saw this word, paradigm, I did not know how to pronounce it. I came into the message and I looked back and I smiled because I used to pronounce it as paradigm. Now I see the meaning that if you're in the message, Christ says, dig me. Christ is depth and is looking for people to dig and to dig him, not dig film stars, soccer stars, entertainment singers of the world. Dig other things, but dig me, saith the Lord Jesus. Our opening scripture is Exodus 25. Verse 9, for paradigm pattern. God says to Moses, this is the paradigm, this is the pattern of how you should build the tabernacle. According to all that I show thee, notice, not what you imagine or suck out of your thumb. The message of the hour is not all that, but it's according to all that I show thee, after the pattern of the tabernacle and the pattern of all the instruments thereof, even so shall ye make it. Now, as a pastor of the local assembly, almost 38 years now, but 9 years assisting in the message, that makes it a little longer than 40 years. I may have not remembered your birthday or your anniversary or your graduation, etc., etc. I may have even failed to visit you when you needed me to. I tried, but I couldn't reach you all. At church, I may not have had the opportunity to shake your hand, since I always have consultation meetings after preaching the sermon and so many people who want to see me. At communion, I may have never had the opportunity as we come around to wash your feet, etc., etc., etc. But may I not fail in this one thing. At Ezekiel 34, verse 2. I must feed you. It's my duty. Now, before we go into this message, the pattern, I want my technicians to put two words in front of you on the slide with the scripture, Exodus 14, 15. There's a word there, move forward. Watch the spelling. Then you come to Deuteronomy 32, verse 20. Be careful. If you don't read that word correct, it may look like forward, but this one is froward. Just an interplay of two alphabets. Forward, we understand, is move on, and that's my encouragement to the local assembly. Times are hard. COVID has done a great deal of damage. The Red Sea is before us, mountains on both sides. Pharaoh's horses breathing behind us, but move forward. The other one, forward, means lastach in Afrikaans. People who involve themselves in things that do not affect them. Our technicians are going to project before you. They have now found proof that the Ohio Bridge was in building and that 16 men fell and died. How many have been forward to say it never happened? I read articles where some say there's no proof of it in the papers. Now God has brought forward the proof. God's hand still reaching out in case among them there is one eagle whose eye has been filmed over and they must reroute and fly back to the message. Here's another word before we go. It is found in Ezra 10:27. Aziza. What attracted my attention to this word, Aziza, is because you read it this way or you read it that way, it's still Aziza. What is the meaning of Aziza? Strong. And I see here how God says to every one of us as Christians, whether things are going against you or things are going for you, be Aziza, be strong. Our journey's end is within sight. The rapture is around the corner. Our technician is going to put before you a quotation by using the keywords big jigsaw puzzle. It's a lengthy quote, but when you read it, the prophet says a jigsaw puzzle is a picture that is cut up into pieces, put in a box and sealed. But with a picture of what the puzzle should be at its finish on top of the box. And he says, may God forgive me. The word of the Lord is like a jigsaw puzzle. Now my approach is God's vision by this message of the hour is already in you. You already have the picture. So the Holy Ghost will take the scriptures and connect them for you when needed. Now we all know that in Luke 10 and 32, the Levite and the priest bypass the wounded man. By now, we've already given you the scriptures in Leviticus where they were told not to defile themselves except it be for mother, father, son, daughter, brother, and virgin sister to the priest. And Jesus used this because the wounded man there, why they went to look, it was to check whether he was related. And then when they saw he wasn't related, their questions were, if I touch him, what will happen to me? But when Jesus, as the Great Samaritan, came to the wounded man, he changed that phrase. He said, if I do not touch him, what will happen to him? So there are always patterns in the scripture, paradigms. If you are selfish, you won't get anywhere. But if you think of your fellow brother and sister, you are moving forward. That's why the prophet says, eternal life is to live for others. If you punch in the exact phrase, this quote will come up. He, apostrophe S, he's done paid the pastor. The prophet is referring to this parable where the innkeeper, the pastor, was given 2 pence, the spirit and the word, to nurse the wounded. If we as ministers fail you in everything else, God will not judge us if we never failed you in preaching the true word to you. We will disappoint you, yes, but we will not disappoint God if we preach the true message to you. The quote comes up from Let Us See God, 1959, 11:29. If the pastor has the Holy Ghost and the word, of course, God has already paid him to take care of you. Our reward is secured as true ministers. That day when we arrive, if we are not truly appreciated now, our hope is in Christ, that our graduation day, our Oscar giving day, is just a few days ahead. Folks, from 1960-0309, the message is, why? Phoenix, Arizona. The exact phrase, your life today will reflect in your children. What we lay down as per preaching the word, one day when we are no more on the scene, the little ones who are listening will say, thank God there was such and such a preacher, and they laid down this word, and today I'm following in that pattern. Now let me give you a few paradigms in scripture. There are so many, I will not be able to cover them in 1 hour. Our technicians will put up just the scriptures. You will read them. Here is a paradigm pattern of how God runs things as per the word generation. Because many questions are coming in saying, but Israel became a nation in 1948. We know the prophet met the angel in 1946. And they put 40 years to that. And they think scripture has failed. Yes, in Psalms 95, verse 10, God speaks of a generation there as 40 years. But are you aware that in Jeremiah 25, verse 10, Israel was to go into the diaspora? They were going to go into captivity to Babylon. And Jeremiah said exactly 70 years. Now here's a quote that our technicians will flesh before you. It comes from Gabriel's instructions, and the exact phrase is, without God, church, song, complete generation. Here to our amazement, the end time vindicated prophet, whom we highly respect, now takes the 70 years of Jeremiah 25:10, and there's a quote before you, and calls it a generation. Then we come to Genesis 6, verse 3, and Genesis 7, verse 1, where God says to Noah, I have found you to be righteous in this generation And then God says in the other scripture, yet their time will be 120 years. So this is a pattern and a paradigm that God may choose when he says, generation, we must not be quick to run. Like those who ran and said the bridge never happened over the Ohio River. What do they say now? So generation may be 40 years, it may be 70 years, or 120. It is God's prerogative. It's God's choice. Which one of those three he was referring to? What the church needs to do is wait on the Lord. You see, patience in the pyramid there, patience in the virtues there, Brother Benham says, is patience with God. It's the church waiting on the husband. Our technicians are going to punch the scripture before you. Let patience have her work. Her. Patience is a her. There's a scripture before you, you see. It's a woman, the church, waiting on the Lord. Now here's another paradigm from scripture. We all know Deuteronomy 23, verse 2. Our technicians will flesh the scripture before you, where it speaks of a bastard child. A bastard child is a child born out of marriage. Not necessarily mother and father are legally married, but the children come out with different colors, and you call the darker one or the other one otherwise bastard. You are misapplying the term. Bastard means from unmarried parents. 10 generations. Our technicians are going to put 10 next to that Deuteronomy 23 verse 2. But then when you come to Deuteronomy 23 verse 8, there it says in the third generation. It's dropping down from 10, and something else here is happening. I don't know with who, but it says third generation. That's 120 years. Then you come to 2 Kings 10, verse 30, 30. There the scripture says fourth generation. So whichever generation you fall under, whether it be 10th or 3rd or 4th, don't be condemned. Don't let the devil play a trick on you to say, so I can't come to church for so many years, or what's happening to me? I've got good news for you. God has got another paradigm pattern, and it is, here it is, flesh before you. 1 Peter 2, verse 9. You are a chosen, holy generation. Over here in 1 Peter 2, verse 9, it no longer limits you to how many years. It says now that Christ has paid the price on Calvary. Salvation is no longer by natural birth or natural genealogy or the color of your skin, the texture of your hair, or the color of your eyes. Now that Christ has paid the price, you are all a holy generation. Thank God. Blessed be the name of the Lord. What a paradigm. What a pattern God has adopted for you in the New Testament. And then you will find a quotation where the prophet speaks of the age of accountability as 12 years. When you punch in the words, that's why at the age of 12, here's a man who was born with a pillar of fire over him. He says he had his first vision at about 3 years of age, heard the voice at age 7, but he says at age 12, I was still not saved because there was a spirit that hung over. Then you will find different quotations where The prophet seems to indicate that accountability, some places it could be 7, because every 7 years our lives changes, indictment message. Some places 8, because you are entering a new system, but this one, he nails it down to 12. It's a paradigm. Some children mature earlier, others are slow, so you cannot use one age for all of them. Others are still babies at 12. But God knows which paradigm to use. Here's another one that's going to bless you. But I'll begin with what you already know, you at the Willows. That in Psalms 119, you're going to read it. We won't put it up. It's very long. It's the longest psalm in the Bible. David sings the 22 alphabets of the Hebrew language, all the way from Aleph to Tav, 22 letters, and he sings 8 verses each. It is a paradigm. Why 8 letters, 8 verses to a letter? Because 8 is eternity, and those alphabets are eternal. But I'm going to move a little further in appealing to you to please visit with me Lamentations of Jeremiah. Lamentations of Jeremiah. Please note it, that chapter 1, and my technicians will only show you the last verse of Lamentations chapter 1. It'll be verse 22. Correct? Then you come to chapter 2 of Lamentations. 22 verses. You come to chapter 4 of Lamentations. 22 verses. You come to chapter 5, 22 verses, and Lamentation ends. But you will say, what about chapter 3? It's got 66 verses. Just like the book of Isaiah's got 66 chapters, 22 plus 22 plus 22. Now, who designs it this way? Who designs that Lamentations chapter 1, 22 verses? Chapter 2, 22 verses. Chapter 3, 66 verses. Chapter 4, back to 22. Chapter 5, back to 22. It's a paradigm. It's a pattern that God uses. Whether I understand it now or not, later he will reveal why. Now we are going a little deeper with paradigm. Our technicians will put up the scripture before you to read. Genesis 12, verse 8. Why is it written like this in Genesis 12, verse 8? The story of Abraham. He was called Abram then. In verse 8 it says, and he removed from thence and unto a mountain on the east of Bethel. Look what God is doing. He's establishing what we call GPS. Postal code, as they say here in the UK. God is establishing a paradigm. He wants to reveal something to you. Unto a mountain on the east of Bethel. So if you go west, you'll miss it. If you go north or south, you'll miss it. It's got to be east of Bethel. And pitched his tent, having Bethel on the west, and Ai, that word Chai, is Ai on the east. And there he built an altar unto the Lord and called upon the name of the Lord. I want to emphasize, built an altar between Bethel and AI. What is God saying? Are you ready? Our technicians are going to put up the following. Right on the left, Bethel, or Bet-El without the H, it's up to you how you want to spell it, but in the King James is B-E-T-H-E-L equals 443. Why? The Hebrew letters have equal numbers per letter. So Bet-El will give you 443. AI or Chai will give you 85. Now, minus 85 from 443, you get 358. Did you know that 358 is the total number of the Messiah? Can you see why he built an altar? He was pre-reflecting Calvary. Because, my dear brothers, God also works in numbers, geography, and mysterious ways. Eden. Look at the numbers that make Eden. 3 + 50, 50. +2 + 70, 70. +4 + 50, 50. It gives you 179. 179 is half of 358, the previous number. 179 is half of 358. So Abram put up an altar to reveal where the altar in Eden was. Which altar, hallelujah, became that day on Calvary, that day on Golgotha. Jesus didn't just die somewhere on the spot of Jerusalem. God's got his paradigms and patterns. He died at the very spot and shed his blood there in Satan's Eden to correct the error of the first Eden. That seed of the woman that was predicted since Eve, here he is. That is why he addressed Mary while he was on the cross. He never said, Mother. He was scriptural. He said, Woman, you are the woman. I am the seed. Folks, paradigms everywhere. The church at the Willows have had countless Sundays on the teachings of the days of creation. I'm not going to go back to them. But we found out that God has a pattern. Read your scriptures carefully. That pattern is, they'll put it up before you, 1 and 4. Below that, 2 and 5. Below that, 3 and 6. Below that, 7. What is this? When you look at the days of creation, what God does on the first day, there he is on the fourth day. If he says, let there be light on the first day, on the fourth day he appoints the sun, the moon, and the stars. He's dealing with light. 2 and 5, he's dealing with waters and the animals of the waters. 3 and 6, he deals with grass and trees, so that on the sixth day, animals who graze the grass and birds who live in trees come up. The seventh stands on its own. It is a paradigm, folks. We've run it through the seals. We've run it through the church ages. I will not repeat that. Then we come to the church ages. There are four beasts around the throne of God, creatures, living creatures. Because the prophet says, do not confuse Tirion and Zun. Zun, Z00N. If you punch that, a quote will come up. Tirion is T-H-E-R-I-O-N. He says, the word beast, they use it a bit carelessly. He says, Zun are the creatures of life around the throne. Tirion are the other beasts, like the dragon that wants to swallow the child from the woman's womb. Now, these four beasts around the throne, the lion, the ox, the man, and the eagle, how do you run them in seven churches? Very lengthy quote, it's in the seals, but you have to go to about five pages to pick it up. The prophet shows that the lion first went forth and it took the first three church ages. Then comes the ox and takes the middle church age, Thyatira. Then comes the man and takes Sardis. Sardis and the other one that follows it, Philadelphia. Then comes the eagle and he takes the last church age. So your pattern paradigm is 3-1-2-1. Once you use this paradigm, the New Testament book of Revelation opens up. The seals run that way. The church ages run that way. The trumpets, the vials, they run that way. But without this paradigm, I've seen people put up charts on the wall. And when they finish their service, the minister is confused. What more the people? You must get the pattern paradigm. Now, we want to come to another paradigm. If you look at the seals, I'm pausing for a while. If you look at the color of the first horse rider, the second horse rider, and the third, they all have distinct colors. White, red, black. Distinct colors. It's the fourth one that hasn't got its own color because it's a mixture of the first three. Then by the time you come to the fifth seal, you find souls under the altar. You come to the sixth seal, woe unto the inhabitants of the earth. By the time you come to the seventh seal, it's a mystery secret for the bride. And how that the last trump that changes our bodies to take us home becomes Moses and Elijah on the earth to call the 144,000. So you see, it's a paradigm. First three seals, distinct colors. The fourth one, mixture. The fifth and the sixth are to do with souls in heaven and souls on the earth, great tribulation. Seventh stands on its own. Watch this. If you study carefully the book of Ezra and Nehemiah, you will come across names like Ezra, Nehemiah, Zerubbabel. They were all men who appeared under the restoration after Babylon had destroyed the temple. These men come back in the restoration. A symbol of how WNB comes at the end after that mystery woman Babylon of Revelation 17 has had almost 2,000 years to destroy things. Here comes a man, plays the part of rebuilding. There's an Ezra ministry in him. There's a Nehemiah ministry in him. There is a Zerubbabel ministry in him. Oh my! Up to where the hand in the book of Daniel wrote on the plaster. And there we see in his own church, while he was teaching the church ages, there's the book of Daniel, or the anointing of Daniel, reappearing in his ministry. A hand wrote in the presence of over 300 people, and they saw it. We are in the restoration, folks. And others declare we are already fully restored. I don't doubt that. The bride is ready. She only awaits a cue from the Lord, a sign to say, come up, let's go. I will read with you Ezra 3, verse 12. When you speak of the restoration, you've got to bring in a picture here where the older men who survived, the captivity of Babylon, they survived the 70 years. They now live up to the time of the restoration, and they see the behavior of the people under the restoration. They wept. The Bible says in Ezra 3 verse 12, the older men wept. Why? They had tasted the first glory. And they were looking at the people under the restoration, how they were not appreciating it. And we are there right now. We have a generation of young people. Some of them do try their best, don't get me wrong. But the majority are just walking into churches and walking out, busy on their phones and earphones. There is not that desperation. So the older men, and they're dying out, most of them, those men who lived in the days of WNB, when they look at the generation of today, they weep. What will be the next 20 years if we are still here? I appeal to the young men and women, grab a hold of this message of the hour and mean business with it. Haggai 2, verse 3, 7 and 9 confirms the same thing. Haggai 2, verse 3 and 7 and 9 confirms. We must not lose the enthusiasm and the appreciation of this message. Now my time is fast running. I want the church and all those who are listening in to study Nehemiah chapter 3. You will come across 10 gates that are being rebuilt. Watch my emphasis. Being rebuilt in the restoration. They are gates. And if you punch in, message believer, 5 gates flesh, 5 gates spirit, many quotes come up. The body has got 5 gates. The spirit realm has got 5 gates. There are your 10 gates. But there must be an 11th. And if you read 2 Kings 11:6. There is a gate with a very strange name, S-U-R. So in the restoration, God is warning us that we mustn't just walk every day carelessly with the five gates of the flesh open, careless. We must have them rebuilt by the Holy Ghost. The see, the smell, the taste, the hear and the feel. Have those gates rebuilt, or the devil is going to attack you severely. Then have your imagination, conscience, memory, reason, affection, the five gates of the Spirit, have them rebuilt. Have them fortified. And God will take care of the soul. There is a paradigm in Scripture. There is a pattern. In Matthew 4:4, the prophet teaches that when the devil tempted Jesus, he used a paradigm of three-pronged attack. And he says Satan will use that on any one of us. He showed in the kingdoms of the earth. Then the pride of life, throw yourself down, and when the angels carry you in the presence of the people, wow, pride. But he had said, turn the stones into bread, the lust of the flesh. So the devil has a paradigm too, a pattern of the lust of the flesh, the pride of life. And watch out for those gates. And Jesus did not overcome the devil by speaking in tongues or manifesting any gift. He did not jump up and down, scream, roll on the floor. He defeated the devil by, it is written, Church of the Willows, this is where I stand. I agree, emotions are part of it. We get excited, I agree. But in the long run, what's going to finally defeat the devil is not all those outward emotions. You've got to know what this message requires. There's another paradigm when you speak of the devil and trials. In all the book of Job, right up to the last chapter, the trials that Job go through can be compressed into seven divisions. The boils and the sores, losing his property, losing his children's lives, having his wife turn against him almost, all those are grouped into seven. It's a paradigm. You'll go through it, somebody else will go through it, I'll go through it. So do not be surprised. All these are patterns of Scripture. Now we are coming to when that temple under Nehemiah, Ezra, Zerubbabel and them, when it was rededicated. The prophet says it was not exactly as it was in Solomon's days, but it was a joyous occasion. Punch in the words, dynamics, refilling. A quote comes up from 1963, 11:24. What shall I do with Jesus called Christ? Notice now, you have been restored. The bright tree has been restored. But without this, you will not succeed. You need a refilling. The dynamics of this church will be a refilling of the Holy Spirit. That we, WMB, have worked in a small measure, meaning in his ministry, while the headstone is coming down to unite with the body. We need that refilling, folks, or else the restoration that Malachi 4 came to effect, came to engage in, will mean nothing if you miss out on the baptism of the Holy Spirit. That's why when you punch the exact words, temple instructed, like instruct, temple instructed. A quote comes up from 1961-07-30, sixfold purpose. He's talking of the temple of Zerubbabel, Ezra, Nehemiah. Then he speaks of when Solomon's anointing, when it was one time anointed in Solomon's days, that anointing carried on through, watch, and it goes on till this very time. That's why the Jews are crying for that temple spot to build their third temple. And the prophet says the anointing is still there. That's why the Jews weep at the Wailing Wall, the last wall on the western side of the fence. It's the same with us. You don't need another kind of Holy Ghost like we see in some so-called message churches. The same Holy Ghost that fell on Pentecost is still the very same Holy Ghost that goes on till this very time. So don't take any duplicates. Don't let any man tell you that he's got the franchise on the Holy Spirit. So-and-so hasn't got the Holy Ghost. That church hasn't got the Holy Ghost. I got the Holy Ghost. It's a lie, folks. Once the Holy Ghost fell on Pentecost, like it fell on Solomon's temple, that anointing carries on till this day. You make sure you get the Holy Ghost as Brother Branham described it, how it behaves. We are going to close, folks. The technicians will put up the scripture before you. Psalms 87, verse 2. Read slowly with me. This pertains to Jerusalem. Jerusalem, the natural, and the Jerusalem that's going to come up and shoot up from below. Come down and shoot up from below. The Lord loves the gates of Zion. We just gave you the 10 gates and the 11th one in the book of Nehemiah and 2 Kings. The Lord loves the gates of Zion more. Watch that word. My technicians are going to blow it up on the screen. More than all the dwellings of Israel. Why is God singling out Zion? Mount Zion, Mount Moriah, they're all the same little undulated hill, same. That's the center of the earth. That's Ezekiel 5:5. That's where the angel pointed. When David wanted to build a temple, God said, the field of Arauna. He pointed. That's where God met with Adam every evening before the fall. God loves that spot. Quote, here are the words, exact words. God thought, cared, little place, Palestine. If not exact, it'll come up on the other side. God thought, cared, little place, Palestine. It'll come from future hope. He says, that's where the new Jerusalem will break up from. Why, therefore, God cares about this little spot in this temple. There's a little spot in your heart because that's the dwelling of the soul. Can you see? As Jerusalem natural, God cares for that spot. You, Jerusalem spiritual, God cares for that spot. It is dwelling place. Revelation 20, verse 9, we are going to read it together before we close. Watch what's going to happen at the end of the millennium. Satan and his angels and his deceived will be bound for the 1,000 years. The 1,000 years will be for Christ and his bride. And in the church age book, the prophet says the 144,000 will be in the glorious millennial reign. When Satan is loosed and the second resurrection takes place, it'll be a resurrection around the world of all those who died without Christ. They will resurrect into the bodies that they died in. What will they do then? Scripture indicates they will hear and see that Christ and his bride are resting and they are gathered around a spot. And here we read, they, the resurrected, went up. You see, they're being resurrected. And then went up on the breadth of the earth, encompassed, surrounded the camp of the saints and the beloved city. They will then attempt to attack, because if they can destroy Christ and his elect, Satan has conquered and he'll take over the world the way he desired since the beginning. Then you will have your war before the white throne judgment. But my emphasis is, look where we will be gathered at the time of the attack, around the beloved city. It's not the new city, Jerusalem. It hasn't shut up yet, because that one comes after the judgment and the earth is cleansed. Oh, God have mercy. There is a paradigm and there is a pattern. That's why when you look at the wedding of Cana, the Bible clearly tells you what day it was. We read it the last service. What I want to emphasize is they'd run out of wine at that wedding, so that Christ can show us in our day, the seventh age, there will be enough wine stimulation of revelation. What? And then Jesus and his disciples were invited to that wedding. Surely you can see Revelation 19:7. The marriage of the Lamb is come. Revelation 22:17. The Spirit and the bride now invites you. That is why when you punch the exact words, National Garb, G-A-R-B, a quote comes up from 65:04:29, the choosing of a bride. The prophet is elaborating the parable of Matthew 22:12. A man without the wedding garment. Here he tells you that the wedding garment is the baptism of the Holy Spirit. I may fail to congratulate you on your birthday, your anniversary, your graduation. I may fail to attend your beloved's funerals. I may fail, but may I not fail in this one thing. Get the Holy Ghost. Watch this pitiful man of Matthew 22:12 before we go. The fact that he pitches and arrives at that wedding feast means he knew the location. Number two, he had the means to get there. Number three, he was inside already. Number four, then when an inspection took place, he was found to be without the garment. He also knew when the wedding would be. But he did not understand the requirements. Look at all the things he knew. But he missed out on one requirement, the garment. Do you know the scripture is happening right now? On the face of the earth are message churches and godly pastors, faithful ministers doing their best. So many people can find these locations and hear these sermons and hear that there's a wedding supper that's coming and all these and all that, and just sit with all the knowledge and fail to acquire the garment, the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Read Matthew 22. Then he was bound up and cast out of the message, cast out where there was gnashing of teeth, meaning loses the possibility of the rapture and ends up in the tribulation where there is gnashing of teeth. It's happening now. Here's a quote. It comes from 63:3:24. Questions and answers. Exact phrase. This was a guest, I know. This was a guest, I know. And then in that quote, the prophet says, notice, he was not the bride. It means it's people who know all about the message, all about this and the other, but they fail to be bride material by the baptism of the Holy Ghost. I'm closing with another paradigm, and then we are done. In the message, standing in the gap, 63:06:23, you are going to do a whole deal of reading. And the key words are going to be peaks. When he saw those seven peaks of Montana, the Holy Spirit said, we even have a picture if they'll put it up for you. The second peak is your first pull. The fifth peak is your second pull. The seventh peak is the third pull. God has even put it in rock and granite and stone. God has given us enough material not to doubt. So what is the paradigm pattern here? Write it down, technician. 2, 5, 7. Before I go, look at how 2, 5, 7 comes into the seals. And my technicians are going to put it there. Second seal, /blood. The red horse, blood being shed. Fifth seal, souls under the altar, blood was shed to kill them. Then you come to the seventh trumpet, Moses and Elijah, their blood will be shed. Read Revelation 11. So I summarize. Second seal, bloodshed, the beast. Fifth seal, those Jews under the altar, blood shed. We know who did it, the beast. Seventh trumpet, two witnesses, Moses and Elijah, blood shed. The prophet says, the beast will send his armies to kill them. It's a paradigm, folks. That is why the prophet says the difference between the wise and the foolish virgins is the paradigm, the pattern. The scissor cuts one in and the scissor cuts one out. Same material that goes to make the dress, same material that's cut out. Folks, may we be found within the paradigm. I'm doing my best, my utmost best. Where I grew up in Malmö Lodi, we even had a word, I'm doing my level best. as a minister, not to fail you in the word. How glorious it'll be that day when we make it together and we hug each other and say, we made it. By his grace, we stuck to the true message and this true Bible. Folks, do not step out of the paradigm. God bless you.
And up the chain, up there we are.